This photo released by the Syrian official news agency Sana, Syrian Deputy Foreign Minister Faisal Miqdad, speaks during a news conference in Damascus, Syria, Saturday, March 10, 2018. Miqdad denied opposition charges that government forces used poison gas in their attacks on Eastern Ghouta. Miqdad added that insurgents groups in the Eastern Ghouta are preparing to fabricate more such attacks to blame the Syrian army. Sana via AP, Associated Press, Beirut. The latest on the developments in Syria, all times local, 11:30 p.m., Syrian opposition member Hadi al-Barra is urging countries to threaten and if necessary take military action to deter all violations of the ceasefire demanded by the UN Security Council throughout Syria, not only for using chemical weapons, he told an informal meeting of the Security Council on Monday, it is feasible. It is necessary, and it is overdue. Al-Barra is a member of the Syrian Negotiation Commission. He spoke to the council after U.S. Ambassador Nikki Haley warned that the United States is prepared to take military action again for chemical attacks that are killing and injuring Syrian civilians. Al-Barra said that if Syrian ally Russia blocks the Security Council from taking measures under Chapter 7 of the UN Charter, action should be taken outside the council to enforce its resolutions. Underscore 10:10 p.m. The United States is urging the UN Security Council to adopt a resolution ordering an immediate 30-day ceasefire in the Syrian capital Damascus and the suburbs of Eastern Ghouta. The draft resolution, circulated Monday and obtained by the Associated Press, expresses outrage at the lack of implementation of a resolution adopted February 24 demanding a ceasefire throughout Syria without delay for at least 30 days to dare humanitarian aid and evacuate the wounded and critically ill. The U.S. draft would eliminate what U.S. Ambassador Nikki Haley called a loophole in the February 24 resolution that allows military operations against Al-Qaeda and Islamist State extremist groups. Haley accused Syria and its Russian allies of exploiting this loophole to continue starving and pummeling hundreds of thousands of innocent Syrian civilians. The draft resolution orders all parties immediately after its adoption to allow safe, unimpeded and sustained access for humanitarian convoys and for medical evacuations. It stresses that any movement of civilians must be voluntary and to appropriate final destinations of their choice. And it asks UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres to urgently develop proposals to monitor a ceasefire and civilian movements from Eastern Ghouta. Underscore 8:30 p.m. Russia's UN ambassador says an immediate ceasefire in Syria would have been utopian and that Moscow prefers a preliminary agreement ahead of sustained escalation in all areas, not just the suburbs of Damascus. Vasily Nebenzia told the UN Security Council on Monday that this is the only realistic way forward, and that it was part of a ceasefire adopted by the Council last month. He said Russia is trying to implement that ceasefire, which has done little to stop the heavy fighting in Eastern Ghouta, outside the capital. He defended Syrian and Russian military operations there, saying the suburbs of Damascus cannot remain a hotbed of terrorism. He accused militants, including those linked to Al-Qaeda, of undermining the ceasefire. The Russian ambassador also warned of a disinformation campaign aimed at blaming Syrian authorities for chemical attacks, saying Al-Qaeda-linked militants were behind a March 5 chlorine attack in Eastern Ghouta. He said such allegations are aimed at preparing the ground for the unilateral use of force against sovereign Syria, alluding to earlier remarks by U.S. Ambassador Nikki Haley, who warned of another military response if the gas attacks continue. Underscore 7:15 p.m. The U.S. ambassador to the United Nations is warning Syria that the United States is prepared to take military action again for chemical attacks that are killing and wounding Syrian civilians. Nikki Haley said that since the Security Council adopted a resolution 15 days ago demanding a ceasefire throughout Syria without delay, there have been three allegations of chlorine gas attacks during a stepped-up military campaign against rebels. This is no ceasefire, she told the council on Monday. The ceasefire has failed. She recalled the U.S. warning after last year's sarin gas attack on Khan Shikun, which an expert panel blamed on President Bashar Assad's government, that it would take action if the council didn't. The Security Council failed to act and the United States successfully struck the airbase from which Assad had launched this chemical attack, Haley said. We repeat that warning today. The United States is prepared to act if we must. She accused Syria, Russia and Iran of using a loophole in the ceasefire resolution allowing military actions against Al-Qaeda and Islamic State militants to bomb and shell schools, hospitals and continue starving and pummeling hundreds of thousands of innocent Syrian civilians. Haley said the U.S. is circulating a new resolution eliminating that loophole and demanding an immediate ceasefire in Damascus and the suburbs of eastern Ghouta to dare humanitarian aid and evacuate the wounded and critically ill. @6:15 p.m. The UN Secretary General says attacks on the Damascus suburbs of eastern Ghouta have intensified since the adoption of a UN resolution demanding a ceasefire, with Syrian government forces driving rebels from more than 60% of the area. Antonio Guterres said Monday that the eastern Ghouta enclave is now split into three separate pockets. Guterres was briefing the Security Council on implementation of the resolution 15 days after its unanimous adoption. It demanded a ceasefire without delay for at least 30 days to dare desperately needed humanitarian aid and evacuate the wounded and critically ill. He noted that the Syrian conflict enters its eighth year on Thursday, saying there has been no cessation of hostilities and the humanitarian and human rights situation is becoming more desperate by the day. Guterres said only one aid convoy has entered eastern Ghouta, making two separate arrivals, and to our knowledge not one critically sick or wounded person has yet been evacuated. @5:40 p.m. French President Emmanuel Macron says France is the most active country in the diplomatic field regarding Syria, after his predecessor called for no-fly zones. At a news conference during a visit to Varanasi, India, on Monday, Macron said his country's actions at the United Nations are unprecedented. He said there's no other country as active as us to get diplomatic results. Former French President François Hollande called Monday for no-fly zones over Syria's Kurdish-held area of Afrin and the eastern Ghouta enclave. Hollande said Macron should keep supporting Syrian Kurdish fighters in Syria and put pressure on Russia through potential sanctions. Macron is pushing for the full implementation of a ceasefire adopted by the UN Security Council last month to allow the entry of humanitarian aid to besieged areas and the evacuation of the injured and sick. @2:10 p.m. A Syrian Kurdish official says thousands of people are fleeing the northern town of Afrin as Turkish troops and Turkey-backed opposition fighters get closer to the besieged Syrian town. Ibrahim Ibrahim, a Europe-based spokesman for the largest Kurdish group in Syria, the Democratic Union Party, or PYD, says those fleeing are heading toward government-controlled areas. He said on Monday that people are fleeing out of fear that Turkish troops and Turkey-backed Syrian opposition fighters might commit atrocities against the Kurds and minorities in the town. Ibrahim described Turkey-backed fighters as extremist groups. He says Turkish troops have destroyed water and power stations that supply the town of Afrin, making it difficult for people to stay. Ibrahim blamed Russia and Turkey for what he called war crimes that are being committed in Afrin. Turkey's Hurriye newspaper reported that civilians are leaving the town of Afrin, heading to government-controlled areas and the town of Manbij, which is held by the Kurdish-led Syrian Democratic Forces. @1:55 p.m. France's former president François Hollande is calling for no-fly zones over Syria's Kurdish-held area of Afrin and the eastern Ghouta enclave. Hollande said in an interview to Le Monde newspaper that it's not possible to celebrate the liberation of some parts of Syria and let whole populations die. He suggested that his successor, Emmanuel Macron, keep supporting Syrian Kurdish fighters in Syria and put pressure on Russia through potential sanctions. Hollande criticized Russia and Turkey for contributing to Syria's crisis. Turkey launched a solo military offensive against the Syrian Kurdish militia known as YPG to clear them from the enclave of Afrin. Ankara considers the YPG a terror organization linked to its own Kurdish insurgency, but France backs the fighters in the war against the Islamic State group. Syrian government forces, supported by Russia, are leading an offensive on the rebel-held eastern Ghouta. @12:30 p.m. Largest rebel group in Syria's eastern Ghouta region, just outside the capital of Damascus, says it has agreed with Russian forces to have wounded people evacuated from the enclave. The Army of Islam said in a statement on Monday that the agreement with the Russians was reached through the United Nations. It says the wounded will be evacuated in stages but makes no mention if they are rebel fighters or civilians. The group also did not say when the evacuations would begin or where the wounded would be taken. Eastern Ghouta has been under a ferocious government offensive since February 18. Leaving more than 1,000 civilians dead. @12:25 p.m. Syrian TV says another group of civilians has left the rebel-held enclave of eastern Ghouta outside Damascus through a corridor established by the Syrian army. The state-run TV broadcast footage showing a small group of men, women and children, it says, left the town of Madyara on Monday. The town was captured by Syrian troops on Sunday. Syrian government forces split eastern Ghouta into amid rapid weekend advances, dealing a major setback to the rebels and threatening to exacerbate an already dire humanitarian situation at the doorstep of the country's capital. The advances also cut off key towns of Douma and Harasta from the rest of the enclave, further squeezing the residents inside them. The UN estimates nearly 400,000 civilians are living under a crippling siege in eastern Ghouta. Copyright 2018, The Associated Press. All rights reserved. This material may not be published, broadcast, rewritten or redistributed.